Lord be with you. You know, I'm so delighted that we're able to gather like this and to worship together in homes and businesses. In fact, I understand some folks, while they're driving on the highway, can sometimes if they got a bandwidth, worship with us live. That's wonderful that we can be connected like that. There are other ways to be connected to during the week. You'll find on our website, wcpc-tx.org, you'll find information about those particular midweek studies, Sunday school classes. We anticipate, in fact, we already have placed several new opportunities that will begin shortly in early September. Other opportunities for you to be able to connect with others and study and fellowship and also take advantage of what we have now and what we have in the fall. And by the way, nothing that we offer is, well, you don't have to be invited. You can invite yourself. Best way to do that, since we don't post the links, is to email myself, email Laura, either the teacher or the study leader. You can email them, and then we will make certain that you get that link so that you can be part of that fellowship or that study. And all are invited, no one's excluded. I hope that you get into those opportunities right now, and in the fall as well. This morning, I call to your attention our moment for mission, or what we now call faith in action, on Project Cure.
Most of the countries where Project Cure works, they would be defined as countries where people make less than $5 a day. At that rate, you just can't afford health care. So Project Cure got started in my mom and dad's garage in 1987. My dad had been doing economic consulting in Brazil, and his interpreter took him to a little clinic in one of these favela neighborhoods, and there was nothing in it, and it really tore my dad's heart out. So he came back to Denver and was telling some friends a story, and then had asked for help, and one of his buddies had a medical wholesale company and donated $50,000 to my mom and dad. So one of the things that makes us really unique is that we always wait for an invitation. We have never pushed our way into a disaster or something like that where people don't want us. We want to be wanted. Second thing that makes us really unique is we always start with a needs assessment. Someone from Project Cure goes to that hospital, meets with the doctors and the nurses. We walk through the entire facility. We make a list, 18 pages, and that's what really formulates our work in that country. It's all custom. It's directed specifically to the needs of that hospital. When we get that needs assessment done, we come back to the United States and we pick out the things that we have in the warehouse that work for that hospital, the most appropriate things we can deliver. That's how we fill those containers, and we ship those containers then right straight to the hospital. This notion that you can get bigger only at the expense of better is a fallacy. We are getting bigger and better at the same time. We're producing better loads, we are fixing equipment, and we are able to offer better equipment into the field. Our needs assessments are getting better, and we're getting bigger. We have a program called Cure Clinics. Cure Clinics is a program where we take doctors and nurses, medical professionals over, and we work side to side with our partners. These are the people who receive the container, and our doctors and nurses go sit down with them and treat patients together. I'm really excited about our new program called Cure Care Trips. This is an opportunity for anybody in the warehouse to come alongside of these containers, go where they are received, and actually unload. Put the boxes away, get the equipment plugged in, make sure that everything works, and make some friends in the process. So to keep this thing called Project Cure going, we really need three things. We need all of the supplies. We also need volunteers, the people to come alongside, and we need money. You know that for $25, you can sponsor the delivery of a box of medical supplies anywhere in the world. The value of what's in that box is about $500. So $25 a month, at the end of the year, we will have delivered $6,000 of the medical supplies.
So if you did not receive an email with that attachment, you can now have access to it on our website. With that in mind, I invite you to join with me in our call to worship. What joy we feel when we are called together, even while we are apart, to celebrate God's love. God's love flows through our lives. This is what it means to be the body of Christ. This is what it means to be faithful witnesses to God. Let us rejoice on this day. Lord, we thank you for the blessings you pour on us. Song, I'm looking out of that prayer garden, which is lit by the glory of the day. God's light shines also into our lives to help us find those places where we are not in accordance with God's call upon us. So together, in confidence that this God of grace and mercy is for us, not against us, let us confess our sins. Have mercy on us, Lord Jesus. We are tormented. Our lives have been disrupted by our own desires and exploits. We are dismayed at your presence, anguished by the awful fallenness of our own failures. We cannot take back what we have said or undo what we have done. Return to the energy we have caused. We are haunted by the past, by the present, fearful of the future. We shrink away from your gaze as strangers outside your circle of blessing. Yet the faith you have planted in us reaches out for your favor, returns to your presence, and hungers for your mercy. Jesus Christ, O Lord, we pray. Amen. Our God greets us with kindness, forgiving our sins, preserving our lives, restoring our souls to the abundant provision of our Lord Jesus Christ. Hear now that for which our faith has hungered, we are forgiven and healed in the name of Jesus Christ.
Today we are continuing the story of Joseph. It didn't go as badly for Joseph as it could have after he was sold into slavery in Egypt. Remember, God was with him and kept him safe. Joseph's gift for dreaming and reading the meaning of dreams also came in handy here. One day the king of Egypt, who was called the Pharaoh, was alarmed by strange dreams. Someone close to the Pharaoh remembered that Joseph could understand dreams. They brought Joseph to the Pharaoh, and he told them about dreaming of 7 fat cows. They were very nice cows, but 7 skinny cows came and ate the nice cows. He also dreamed of 7 plump stalks of grain and 7 thin stalks. The thin stalks ate the thick stalks like in his other dream. What could it mean? Joseph took some time to pray and to get some help from God to understand these dreams. After getting help, Joseph told the Pharaoh both dreams meant the same thing. Egypt would have 7 years of plenty of food and the crops would grow well. In fact, they would have more food than they could eat. Then 7 years would follow, where there would be hardly any food. The animals and plants wouldn't grow because there wasn't going to be any rain. This is called a famine. The Pharaoh was very concerned about what to do. Joseph told him to put someone in charge of the food during the 7 years of plenty of food to save and store the extra for when there would be very little food. Joseph was put in charge of doing this by the Pharaoh. Soon the things that God had shown Joseph happened just as God had said. Joseph was in charge during the years of famine of giving out the food that Egypt had stored. And guess who also needed food during the time of the famine? None other than Joseph's brothers. They heard that Egypt had stored their food and journeyed to ask the family for help. All the older brothers went, and they didn't even recognize Joseph when they arrived at the food storage place. Joseph was very surprised to see his brothers again. He decided to forgive them and asked them to bring his father Jacob, who was called Israel, and his youngest brother also to live with Joseph in Egypt. Joseph took care of his family, and the Pharaoh was good to Israel for a time, until the time of Moses, but that's another story. Will you pray with me? Loving God, you have a plan for our lives, just like you did for Joseph. Help us to follow you and to forgive those who hurt us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Secured our future and restored us to relationship with God. Remove the shame and fear that cause us to cower in your presence. And by the power of your Holy Spirit, open our eyes and our hearts to your word of love, mercy, healing, and blessing. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Listen now to God's word to us as we find it in Genesis 45. And Joseph could no longer control himself before all those who stood by him. And he cried out, "Send everyone away from me." So no one stayed with him when Joseph made himself known to his brothers. And he wept so loudly that the Egyptians heard it, and the household of Pharaoh heard it. Joseph said to his brothers, "I am Joseph. Is my father still alive?" But his brothers could not answer him, so dismayed were they at his presence. Then Joseph said to his brothers, "Come closer to me." And they came closer. He said, "I am your brother Joseph, whom you sold into Egypt. And now do not be distressed or angry with yourselves because you sold me here. For God sent me for you to preserve life. For the famine has been in the land these 2 years, and there are 5 more years in which there will be neither plowing nor harvest. God sent me before you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to keep alive for you many survivors. So you who sent me here, but God, he has made me a father to Pharaoh, and a lord of all his house, and ruler over all the land of Egypt. Hurry and go up to my father and say to him, 'Thus says your son Joseph, God has made me lord of all Egypt. Come down to me. Do not delay. You shall settle in the land of Goshen, and you shall be near me. You and your children and your children's children, as well as your flocks, your herds, and all that you have, I will provide for you there, since there are 5 more years of famine to come, so that you and your household and all that you have will not come to poverty. And now your eyes and the eyes of my brother Benjamin see that it is my own mouth that speaks. You must tell my father how greatly I am honored in Egypt and all that you have seen. Hurry and bring my father down here." He fell upon his brother Benjamin's neck and wept, while Benjamin wept upon his neck. And he kissed all his brothers and wept upon them. And after that, his brothers talked with him. This is the word of the Lord. God. Now, unless you have grown up in the era of video streaming and DVRs, you may be like me, and you may have counted on the previously on intro to television serials as an opportunity to dash to the restroom or to get a drink or even to get home from your meeting or an event, so as to not miss anything in the show that was to come. Depending on the program, and the segment would recap what had happened last week. We would look back over several episodes in order to set up the plot for that week. Honestly, shows might still do this, but since I rarely watch television live and I often watch an episode or three of my favorite serials in a row on my favorite streaming services, I don't know if it's still a thing. Is it? Regardless, I don't need it anymore. However, our lesson this morning is the perfect opportunity for a previously on-style recap. So here goes. When we last saw our hero Joseph and his brother, in a fit of jealousy and anger, they had cast Joseph that arrogant, spoiled, favorite son, Tattletail, into a pit. And instead of killing him or leaving him for dead, as some of them had wanted, they sold him to some Ishmaelite traders and slavery in Egypt. There, at the beginning of the Joseph saga, life looked pretty bleak for Joseph and for his brothers, for Jacob as well. And while we know and trust that God was not finished with any of them yet, it still felt pretty hopeless. Since then, and before our reading today, over 20 years have passed, and much has happened to Joseph and to his brothers. At every turn, our not-quite-a-hero Joseph is able to turn lemons into lemonade. When he was a slave in Potiphar's house, Joseph rose in regard and responsibility until Potiphar's wife cried foul when Joseph refused to be seduced by her. So he was thrown in jail, only to find there, in that place, the care of a jailer and another opportunity to advance within his circumstances. Now, as you may recall from last week, Joseph's dreams were the thing that caused him the most trouble and the greatest amount of hatred from his brothers. However, there in his jail cell, the dreamer Joseph was able to put his talents to work, first interpreting the dreams of two of Pharaoh's servants who had fallen out of favor, and then later, the dreams of Pharaoh himself. And because of this interpretive work, Joseph was not only free, but he was given charge of Pharaoh's house. He was tasked with stockpiling grain in the 7 years of plenty that Pharaoh dreamed of, for the 7 years of famine that were to follow. Joseph was given title. He was given a new name. He was given an Egyptian wife. He had a family. Joseph was a governor in the land. He was father to Pharaoh. He was a king's counselor. Pretty good for Joseph. But meanwhile, back in Canaan, things weren't quite so rosy for the rest of Joseph's family, for his father, for his brothers. The famine that Pharaoh had dreamed of in Egypt had come to the whole land, and so Jacob sent 11 of his sons down into Egypt to buy food, because they had it there. Benjamin, the youngest and only other child of Jacob's favorite wife, Rachel, stayed behind. Joseph recognized his brothers immediately, but they only saw an Egyptian official in the man before them. This would have been the perfect opportunity for Joseph to take his revenge on his brothers who thrown him into that pit. He could have had them arrested. He could have had them carried off, just like they had done so many years before. Instead, Joseph played mind games with them. As one commentator describes it, he lures them into a cruel game of cat and mouse. Yes, Joseph did sell them grain, but then he concealed the money that they paid back in their packs. So when they discovered it, they fled Egypt for fear of being accused of theft. And before their departure, Joseph had also demanded that if they were to return, that they should bring their youngest brother with them before they could receive any more assistance. But at Jacob's insistence, the brothers returned to Egypt to buy more food. This time, with Benjamin in tow, for Joseph's demands. Once again, that Egyptian official who stood before them played mind games with his brothers, eventually sending them away, but detaining his brother, Benjamin. Judah returns to plead for his brother's release, much as he had long ago for Joseph's life to be spared. This time, Judah offered himself in exchange for Benjamin, because he knew that Benjamin's captivity would kill their father. This is where we rejoin our story this morning. There in that situation, having heard Judah's pleas, having seen his brothers, Joseph could no longer contain himself. He broke down. Joseph wept, revealing himself to be their long-lost brother, the one they thought was dead. Here, in that tear-filled reunion, we find the story we started last week come around full circle. This second encounter between Joseph and his brothers is the emotional climax of the entire Joseph saga. It culminates in Joseph's forgiveness of his brothers. As biblical scholar Walter Brueggemann explains, this passage is the primary resolution of the entire Joseph narrative. He writes, "Everything before has pointed to this. After this, everything is descriptive." The betrayal that we read last week had left Joseph enslaved and left Jacob wailing and weeping in grief for his lost and favorite son. That betrayal has come back around with a wholly different kind of tears. Tears of Joseph. Tears of the brothers. Tears of joy at reunion. And just as the rivalry and unjust favoritism we heard about last week is a major theme in Genesis, so is the theme of reconciliation and forgiveness we get to hear about this week. As I prepared for last Sunday, I came across the suggestion of one commentator who says that perhaps Jacob had sent Joseph into the fields looking for his brothers with the hope that they would have the same kind of reconciliatory moments that he and Esau had had when Jacob and his family returned to the land. But could not have happened when his sons were young and impulsive, and their tempers were still hot on the heels of Joseph and his dreams. This final evil to occur here in Egypt, many years later. Even if Joseph's brothers weren't able to fully trust his assurances of forgiveness. However, what we and the brothers, and perhaps even Joseph, learn in our lesson this week is that the long-sought forgiveness is centered and grounded in the love and the work of God. God, whose name was almost entirely absent from our scripture last week. The God whose presence was everywhere felt. Joseph tells his brothers, "God sent me here before you to preserve life. God sent me before you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to keep you alive for many, and keep alive for you many survivors." God had been at work, Genesis tells us, all of this time, all these many years, redeeming the hurts of Joseph and his brothers, healing their hatred. Healing their deeply sinful actions. The story of Joseph and his brothers is really an analogy. It's a microcosm of the whole story of Genesis, the whole story of God's work throughout history. After After all, it's God, not Joseph, who is the subject of the most powerful verbs in this passage. God saved. God made. God preserved. If you think about it, the whole arc of God's work, from creation to present, is moving us toward forgiveness, reconciliation, justice, and love, even when our own inclinations, like those of Joseph and his brothers, would have us do just the opposite. The forgiveness and reconciliation that they found in that place was not easy. It didn't just happen because, boom, God commanded it. It happened after many, many years, and as one commentator suggests, the very hard work of trying to see, of trying to dream as God sees, as God dreams. Here at the conclusion of Genesis, God was redeeming Joseph and his brothers through their reconciliation. Not only for the peace that it would bring for them, but also for the life it would bring for the generations that were to come. This justice-bringing, love-bearing, forgiving, reconciling work doesn't stop with Joseph and his brothers. The same powerful, loving, forgiving God brought a foolish and stiff-necked people out of the land of Egypt when they cried out from slavery, brought them into a land that had been promised to them for many generations. And then through judges and prophets and even some kings, that same God would continue to call that same people back again and again and again into the same reconciling arc of love and justice that we hear today. And at its heart, at the heart of the gospel, at the heart of the good news, at the heart of what we believe, this is the same work that Christ embodied. This is the same work that he lived, that he taught, that he died, that he rose for, so that we could be reminded once again of the love of God. That we could be reminded of this arc of reconciliation and forgiveness that have run from the earliest days of creation and run far off into eternity. We are reminded that God, that Christ works to reconcile us one to another, to reconcile us to ourselves, to reconcile us to God. Love your enemy, Jesus said. There he invites us alongside the many who, like Joseph, have gone before into the art of hard and beautiful reconciling work of God. But friends, we only need to open up a newspaper or turn on the television or look out at the world around us to know that we are so, so far off from that reconciled dream, from that world of peace, to that place of forgiveness. Our society has become and is becoming even more polarized, whether it's our politics, or discussions of religion, or even sports. In all of these places, we're finding it harder and harder and harder to find some common ground. So, our text this week may be asking us, where are we called to take our place in this work of reconciliation in the world? It's hard to think about where to begin, isn't it? But as Will Gaffney, who's a Hebrew Bible scholar, writes, Remembering Joseph means remembering that some families are deeply troubled. She also writes, remembering Joseph means reminding ourselves that even in the most deeply troubled family, forgiveness and healing are possible. Even in the most deeply troubled family, even in the most deeply troubled society, even in the most deeply troubled world, forgiveness and healing are possible. That's good news. So maybe we can join in this work of reconciliation, but maybe we need to do it by starting small. Maybe we do it by forgiving the small frustrations in our lives, by the family member who forgives and load the dishwasher, or that neighbor who starts mowing their lawn early in the morning the one day you get to sleep in. Maybe we start the work of reconciliation by trying to heal hurts in strained relationships with a family member, or a friend, a co-worker, or a teacher. Perhaps we join in the arc of God's reconciling and forgiving love by joining in works of justice and reconciliation in our larger world. We do this when we recognize our participation in actions that have hurt others, when we ask for forgiveness, and we seek to restore the damage that we may have caused. Perhaps we join this reconciling, this forgiving work, by showing some grace to one of the ones that it's hardest to do. Perhaps we can even find forgiveness for ourselves. This loving, forgiving, justice-bringing, reconciling work is not a task nor is it something that we can bring into completion. But here and now, in this place, in our lives, we can take up God's invitation into the work we see being done by Joseph, the work we see being done by his brothers, the work we have come to know in Christ, the work dreams. We could join in this business of reconciliation. May it be so. Let us pray. Loving God, we find it easy to turn to you again and again and again and ask for forgiveness. We find it very hard to practice that same reconciling, forgiving love that you have shown to us. Guide us and encourage us, and help us as we seek to join you in this hard and life-giving work, so that your world and your people may flourish. Amen. I invite you now to confess the faith of the church using the statement of faith that you find printed in your bulletin that you'll see on the screen that we find from the Confession of 1967. To be reconciled to God is to be sent into the world as God's reconciling community. This community, the Church Universal, is entrusted with God's message of reconciliation. It shares God's labor of healing the enmities which separate people from God and from each other. Christ has called the church to this mission and given it the gift of the Holy Spirit. The church maintains continuity with the apostles and with Israel by faithful obedience to his call. The life, death, resurrection, resurrection and promised coming of Jesus Christ has set the pattern for the church's mission. His human life involves the church in the common life of all people. His service to people commits the church to work for every form of human well-being. His suffering makes the church sensitive to all human suffering, so that it sees the face of Christ in the faces of persons in every kind of need. His crucifixion discloses to the church God's judgment on the inhumanity that marks human relations and the awful consequences of the church's own complicity in injustice. In the power of the risen Christ and the hope of his coming, the church sees the promise of God's renewal of human life in society and of God's victory over all wrong. The church follows this pattern in the form of its life and in the method of its action. So to live and serve is to confess Christ as Lord. Amen.
Call your attention again that on our homepage you'll find for which it will continue to be there. And I invite you to either try a copy or to refer to it and use it in your own life of prayer. I also have some other requests that I would share with you. We certainly want to remember the schools. Most of the schools in this area started classes on Wednesday. Please pray for the teachers, the administrators, the students, the parents, for their safety and their well-being in this difficult time that we're all living through. Also, we've been asked to pray for Nancy Battle. Nancy had back surgery and is recovering from that. Pray for her release of pain and for speedy recovery. And also, let us pray for Kendra Holtzman, Kendra's nephew. He's been just 2 years old, died on Friday. Very tragically. Let's pray for Kendra as she grieves her sister, as she grieves her entire family, as they grieve such a painfulness. With these, as well as those other concerns that find your hearts, let us spend some time with God. God of mercy and healing, you are Lord of all. You embrace those who are strangers. You bless the past. You reconcile the rejected. We cry out to you in confidence that your provision is abundant, infinitely more than enough to preserve the church, redeem the world, and help and comfort those who grieve. Those who see you right now, so many, so little hope for the future. We pray for your people, the house of Israel, and for households of faith near and far. And we pray that your church, this church, and other churches will find common ground in all faiths as we seek justice and mercy. As we seek to redeem that which is lost. We pray for your church that it will demonstrate your reconciliation, model your mercy, and bring about healing and wholeness. There is so much brokenness and pain. May we not turn our eyes away from it, but may we seek to sit in it. Your good creation. Help us to be good stewards so that our children, grandchildren, 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 all the generations that follow will be amazed at as wondrous we are today. We pray for reconciliation, new beginnings, for families that will bring them, for the visions that divide us from others because of nationality, language, race. And we pray for reconciliation, new beginnings for nations, and especially we pray for our nation as we approach this pray that we might find unity in seeking justice for all. Imitate mercy, especially for those who are marginalized. Help us to be willing to allow our lives to suffer so that other lives that are suffering now can be relieved. Help us to join together the giving of ourselves away and some of the divisions that are so deep. For their parents, their families, their teachers, their school administrators, we pray that all be safe and healthy and help us to walk with faith at this time. Help us to be able to do so. As we pray, we pray for all those listed on our prayer list. Pray for Nancy Pavone for her recovery from surgery, but her recovery will be full and complete. And on a silent set of words, we pray for others. We know, perhaps even ourselves, who are struggling, who feel overwhelmed. We give you thanks for all those who, through their faith, have encouraged us. We ask that we might do the same for others. Encourage them. Stand with them as we follow after your Son. If you call us for prayer, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors, and lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom, the power, and glory forever. Amen. You know, the work of the church is a work of reconciliation. And so as we offer our gifts today, our gifts that have already been sent, gifts that will be sent later, however it is that you give in a variety of ways that I know you're aware of by now, but however it is that we give our financial support to the life of this congregation, all of it is seeking, and all of us are seeking together as the body of Christ to be reconciled to us. So let us worship. We seek to do that now with our giving, with our living. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.